Hey, good morning, church family. Pastor Hunter here with you. And I just want to tell you, we are so glad and excited you chose to join us this morning at The Way Bible Church. If this is your first time here, we have a new here card in the seat back in front of you. And we ask you to just fill that out for us. That's a way that we can get to know a little bit more about you and have somebody connect with you. If you'll just grab that card, fill it out, and turn it in at any of our giving stations here around the church, we would love to connect with you after service. Also, speaking of connecting with you, we have a Connect card in that seat back in front of you as well, and you can just scan a QR code, and we have all of the avenues and options on how to connect with you here at TWBC. Those are ways to connect with you like water baptism, joining the church through Next Steps, and joining a community life group that we offer here at TWBC. And if there's not a group that you see that you want to be a part of, we have a way that you can host a group, join a group, or all of the above. This summer, we are all going back to Camp Victory in Manford, Oklahoma for our summer camps. From 2nd to 5th grade, our middle schoolers and our high schoolers are all going to the same camp, and it's all taking place in the month of July. If you have any questions, contact me or Miss Rachel about where to sign your kids up for summer camp. Our middle school slots are full right now, but we do have a waiting list, but we have spots for high school and 2nd through 5th grade kids at this time. You can sign your kid up through TWBCSS.com/events. Our young adult ministry takes place every 2nd and 4th Tuesday of every month. We want you young adults, if you are 18 to 29 years old, we want you to be a part of this ministry. Sometimes they have hangouts, sometimes they have services, and we want you to invite every young adult that you know so we can have this place packed out with young people ready to worship Jesus. Speaking of worshiping Jesus, service is about to start soon, and we cannot wait to worship with you.
Let's worship today the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's worthy of it all. Amen. Let's sing this. Your blood is healing every wound.
My hope and my defense, your blood.
to the Way Bible Church. We are so glad that you came and you joined us today. No matter if you're watching online with us this morning or you're here in the room, man, we're glad you're here. We're so glad to see you. We really mean that. We are glad to see you because we know when you come into this place that God wants to meet you here and wants to change your life. And so today, before we get started, man, we're going to continue on in worship. We're going to sing a few more songs, and I can't sing them without thinking of something that is so cool to me. And we're going to sing about the name of Jesus. We're going to sing about the blood of Jesus. We're going to sing about how we trust in God. And in all of creation, man, that we are so unique in this. There are people that were born before the time of Jesus Christ coming to the earth, and they worshiped God through sacrifice. They worshiped God through keeping the law. And then Jesus came to the earth, and people continued to worship him, but they worshiped him after they saw what he did. Because some people, we know, they didn't believe he was the Messiah, and some people did, and they responded in worship that way. And then Jesus died. That's good news, right? And then Jesus died, and he didn't stay dead, but he rose victorious. And after Jesus rose, he ascended into heaven. And so us, at this time in 2024, we are among the group of people that are the only ones ever in history that will get to choose to worship the risen Savior, Jesus. What I mean by that is, man, his word tells us that one day, everybody say one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. Every knee and every tongue, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Every person, it says, on earth, in heaven, and below the earth. That means even angels and demons will kneel and they will confess that he is Lord. But today, we're here on this earth and we're in that waiting period. And we get to choose to worship him. He gives us free will, and that's a beautiful thing, because what free will does in worship is it requires a sacrifice. It requires us to sacrifice our time. It requires us to sacrifice our attention and our focus. And we are the only people in history that get to choose to worship the risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And so today, man, no matter who you are, how old you are, how much money you've got in your bank account, where you came from, how far you drove, man, today you get to choose. You woke up with breath in your lungs, and so you get to choose to say, Lord, I give you that breath right back in praise. I give you that breath right back in worship. And so today that's what we want to do. As always, we've got communion here. If you and your family want to come and take communion, and we've got altars that are open the whole service. We don't have to wait till the last song or till the closing of the service for you to respond to what Jesus is doing. But man, today, I think it's just healthy for us to stop for a second and say, man, I get to choose to do this. No one's forcing me. In other countries, people are persecuted and killed for singing to the Lord, right? But man, today, we get to choose. And so wherever you are right now, man, can I ask us to do something? To just bow your head and lift your hands to Jesus. Man, just as a sign of surrender. And God, today, God, we just stop. God, we thank you that we are those people that get to, God, just respond to you with a choice. God, a choice to say thank you. A choice to bless your name. A choice to stop and to remember how powerful you are, to remember how wonderful you are, to remember how beautiful you are. God, we thank you that you were exalted and given the name above all names, so that at every knee would bow and every tongue would confess at the name of Jesus. God, that every bit of darkness would come into light at the name of Jesus. God, that every bit of brokenness would be made whole at the name of Jesus. And God, today we truly stop. We stop our plans. God, we stop our preference, and we say, God, whatever it is that you want to say and however it is that you want to move, God, we welcome you in this place. Jesus, we welcome you here. We thank you for loving us enough to come and to die and to raise to life so that we could be raised to life. God, we thank you that the old is gone and behold, the new has come. God, I thank you at the name of Jesus. And and we just lift it high. God, we lift high the name of Jesus. We bless you, God, today. We give you all of our worship. It's the name of Jesus we pray.
Now revealed in you are.
blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time, and born of his spirit, and washed in his blood. And what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Come on, sing. And I trust in God, my Savior.
Come on, you can do better than that. Give God some praise this morning. Hey, just before Pastor G goes off stage here real quick, this is Pastor G. I'm Pastor Derrick. There seemed to be some confusion over the last few weeks. I just want to point that out. Anyway, let's give our kids a hand as they're going out to... Thank you guys so much for joining us for worship this morning. I know I'm going to have a meeting with Pastor Joe when he gets back this week, but wanted to make sure that we all are on the same page and know what we are supposed to be calling each other. Amen? Hey, I'm so excited for you guys this morning for being here. I'm so excited for you guys joining us online. Thank you for joining us online. Hey, we have been in a series called Unsung Heroes, and I get the privilege of continuing that series today. And again, I'm Pastor Derrick. I'm one of the executive pastors here at the church, I'm also an acting elder as well. So I don't take this lightly, being able to be up here in front of you guys, to be able to bring what God has put on my heart to share this morning. And if you need to follow along with the sermon notes, each and every week you can go to our website, twbcss.com /notes, and you can get all the notes each and every week when we have a message here that you could take notes actually on the website. You can email them to yourself so you can be able to have that for you. So whatever God lays on your heart, you can go ahead and put those in those notes. So that is always available, twbcss.com/notes. Also, Pastor Joe is in Peru this week, and he is not on vacation. He is actually there pouring into other pastors. Friday night, he met with 300 leaders of a church that has 7,000 members. And he is pouring into those pastors because that is truly his heart. Tomorrow, he's actually meeting with 70 senior pastors in Peru. So what you're doing, your prayers and everything, it matters here at the Way Bible Church. We don't take any of that lightly. If you want to do anything for your pastor, your lead pastor, any of your pastors, staff, elders, whatever, pray. Yeah. Always continue to lift us up in prayer. Because we truly appreciate it, and we know that our church body is praying for us. And as you turn in your Bibles to Joshua 14, we're going to start at verse 6. In the seat back in the chair in front of you, there's three cards. We have a Connect card that we would love for you guys to be able to find out how to get involved here at the Way Bible Church, whether it's community life, whether it's a baptism, or you want to join the church, you can scan that QR code and sign up for any one of those items here at TWBC. Also, if this is your first time here, first of all, I want to say welcome. Welcome to the Way Bible Church. We appreciate you coming to worship with us this morning. And if you fill that card out and place them in any one of the giving stations in the back of the room or throughout the foyer, we would love to be able to send you something next week, because we truly, truly appreciate each and every one of you coming here to worship with us here at TWBC. And the last thing is the offering envelope and all the ways to give here at TWBC. We have those as well in the back of the chair. So I've given you enough time to find Joshua. And as we continue this Unsung Hero, Pastor Joel opened this series up with the encourager, be a Barnabas. We're all called to encourage one another. We're all called to lift one another up. And I can tell you, as Pastor Joel has said many times, the hardest thing on a Sunday morning is coming from behind that curtain to this podium each and every week. And that encouragement that you guys give us, the encouragement that you give one another, it matters to a believer's life. So continue to truly embrace being an encourager here at the Way Bible Church. And last Sunday, Pastor Jeff gave us a word on simple obedience. It might be simple, but it may not be easy. And that's where the power of God comes in, because what he's asking us to do is very simple, but it might not be easy. So if you guys have not heard any of those, you are welcome to go back to our website and do that. But I want to continue this series today, and my title is Tip of the Spear. And tip of the spear, and this is more of a warrior term, and how I believe the calling on this church and this body, that we are called to be the tip of the spear in this area. We're called to face challenging things head on. We're called to take new ground for the kingdom of heaven. I truly believe that we are called to expand the kingdom of heaven in this four-state region and beyond. So an unsung hero is defined as one who does great deeds but receives little or no recognition. And today, as we talk about the tip of the spear, I want to recognize some unsung heroes here. And what you guys don't understand or don't know, may not know, is each and every week, it takes about 100 volunteers to get things going on a Sunday morning. 100 volunteers. And many of those guys, all of those guys, I take that back, all of those guys and gals are unsung heroes to us. So just because I'm highlighting a few people, I want to make sure that we appreciate everything that you guys do, from the prayer team to the cafe team to the children's ministry, the parking lot team, and all those in between. We appreciate what you guys do here at TWBC. But I want to recognize our safety team this morning. We have some men and women. We have some men and women who have stepped up and wanted to be able to be a line of defense, if you will, in a lot of areas. Unfortunately, in the day and time that we live in, the church is a target for a lot of things. But our safety team is there, got things in order to make sure that you guys have a welcoming place each and every week to come in here and worship our God. So I want to definitely acknowledge our safety team this morning. So go ahead and give them a hand again. So now I've given you enough time to find Joshua, and that's right. Did I tell you the scripture? Yeah, I think you did. Yeah, Joshua 14, starting at verse 6, and we're going to go into the Old Testament. So it says, the sons of Judah drew near to Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh. Okay, let me stop real quick. I was born in Louisiana. I moved to Illinois. And now I'm back here in Texas, so my pronunciations, just like that word, may not be good, but it's okay to chuckle if I miss up a word. It's all right to laugh at me. And this is a whole side note. So yesterday, you ever wanted something so bad that you ignored all the warnings? All the warnings. Like all the warnings. Yesterday, the weatherman, which I don't believe, that's just part of the issue, said there's going to be rain. The weatherman said it's going to be wind. The weatherman said it's going to be lightning. I wanted to go fishing so bad. We had a small group, our TWBC tournament bass fishing. We had an event yesterday. We got on the water at 6:30, and we were heading home at 8:15. So you can laugh at my stupidity. I'm okay with you laughing at me and a few of us. I'm not by myself, a few of us. So anyway, as we read into this, if I pronounce the words wrong, please forgive me, and I'm just going to keep moving on over. So then the sons of Judah drew near to Joshua in Gilgal, and Caleb the son of Jephunneh, the Kizzenite, said to him, you know the word which the Lord spoke to Moses, the man of God, concerning you and me and Kadesh Barnea. I was 40 years old when Moses, the servant of the Lord, sent me from Kadesh Barnea to spy out the land, and I brought word back to him as it was in my heart. Nevertheless, my brethren who went up with me May the heart of the people melt with fear, but I followed the Lord my God fully. So Moses swore on that day, saying, surely the land on which your foot has trodden will be an inheritance to you and to your children forever, because you have followed the Lord my God forever. Now behold, the Lord has let me live just as he spoke these 45 years from the time that the Lord spoke this word to Moses when Israel walked in the wilderness. And now behold, I am 85 years old today. I am still as strong today as I was on the day Moses sent me. As my strength was then, so my strength is now for war and for going out and coming in. Now then, give me this hill country. Some virgins say, give me this mountain about which the Lord spoke on that day. For you heard that day that the Anakim were there with great fortified cities. Perhaps the Lord would be with me and I will drive them out as the Lord has spoken. So Joshua blessed him, gave Hebron to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, for an inheritance. So kind of wanted to bring you up to this. As everybody knows, the children of Israel was in Egypt as slaves for 400 years. And Moses delivered them out of there, brought them through the Red Sea and everything, and then gets them to the promised land. Moses sends 12 spies to go spy out the land. They came back, and 10 of the spies, except for Caleb and Joshua, gave a bad report. Because of their disobedience and not believing God, God made the children of Israel walk in the wilderness for 40 years until that whole generation had died out. And this is now where we come back to it. Moses has died. Joshua is now the new leader. They have conquered the walls of Jericho. And now Caleb is saying, give me my mountain. Give me what was promised to me. So who was Caleb? Moses sent spies, one from each of the 12 tribes, into Canaan to scout out the territory. Among them, as I said, was Joshua and Caleb. All the spies agreed on the richness of the land, but 10 of them said Israel could not conquer it because its inhabitants were too powerful. Their cities were like fortresses. Only Caleb and Joshua dared to contradict them. Listen, after that report back from the spies, Caleb and Joshua were the only two of the 12 that made it to see the promised land. Now Caleb came to collect what was promised to him 45 years ago. Numbers 13 says, then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, we should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we surely will overcome it. God was so angry at the Israelites and their lack of faith in him that he forced them to wander into the desert 40 years, until that entire generation had died off except Caleb and Joshua. After the Israelites returned and set about conquering the land, Joshua, the new leader, gave Caleb the territory around Hebron belonging to the Anakites. These giants, descendants of the Nephilim, had terrified the original spies, but proved no match for God's people. Listen, I believe that there is some people in here with a Caleb-like tenacity. And I think it's on the inside of every one of us to have Caleb-like tenacity. There are so many things in our life that cause us to fear, cause us to not believe, cause us not to believe in who God sees us as, and we don't let loose the Caleb tenacity that we have. Caleb's name means raging with canine madness. He represents the tribe of Judah for which Jesus came. So listen, I want to explore some of the characteristics of Caleb because you can be able to see what it takes to have the tenacity that a Caleb had back in the day. Number one, Caleb had strength. Caleb was physically strong. Joshua 14, 10, and 11 says, now behold, the Lord has let me live just as he spoke these 45 years from the time that the Lord spoke this word to Moses. When Israel walked in the wilderness, and now behold, I am 85 years old today. I am still as strong today as I was the day Moses sent me. My strength was then, so my strength is now for war and for going out and coming in. So how many of us could say that what Caleb said? Most people in their 80s can barely move. They can barely walk. Some have to use a walker. Some are in a nursing home. Caleb was strong at 80 years old. 80 years old. I mean, let's take that into consideration. We think of an 80-year-old man, his bones might be brittle, not all, for that matter, 45-year-old man probably don't have the strength that Caleb had at this time. Caleb was still doing battle in his 80s. He was still kept climbing mountains in his 80s. He was still killing giants in his 80s. He was the 80-year-old giant killer. He was 80 years young. Are we strong or are we weak as believers? Are we young at heart, even if we are physically old? How strong are you? Number two, Caleb had optimism. Caleb had hope about the future. Many people, as they get older, become negative and critical. They become cranky. They become grouchy and grumpy. Caleb was different. Caleb was different. Caleb could have been some guy that's walking through the wilderness with the other children of Israel for 40 years, mad as a hornet at them. I know I would have been. And I know the story as I'm reading it on this side of it, but if God said that he's going to let them die out, I would have been in the wilderness checking them off. Thank God I was not Caleb at that time. Caleb is old, but he is positive and he is optimistic. Every time you see him in Scripture, he has this characteristic about him. 12 men were sent to spy out the land in Numbers 13. And it says this, see what the land is like. This is Moses talking. And whether the people who live in it are strong or weak, whether they are few or many, how is the land in which they live? Is it good or bad? And how are the cities in which they live? Are they like open camps or with fortification? How is the land? Is it fat or lean? Are there trees in it or not? Make an effort then to get some of the fruit of the land. Now the time was the time of the first ripe grapes. Listen, Caleb and Joshua were two of these spies. Caleb represented the tribe of Judah. Joshua represented the tribe of Ephraim. The 12 spies did their job for 40 days, and 40 days later came back with a report. But listen, there were two different reports because the spies could not agree. They agreed on the facts. They disagreed on the interpretation. There was a majority report and a minority report. Listen, one report focused on problems and one focused on God. The majority report focused on the problems. It was negative and pessimistic. I didn't share this in first service, and I feel led to share this service. A little over a year ago, a young man came into our life, our family life, and went through some stuff over the last 8 months that I couldn't wish that on my worst enemy. But I'm going to tell you, through it all, he was so positive. It was something with his leg, and they said that if, he said at the very worst, they may have to remove the leg. And his response was, well, that's it. Go ahead and do it so we can move on. And in that moment of being able to walk with him through that time, I can't tell you how much I reflected on myself and how optimistic I was not. And normally, I'm a glass full kind of guy. I don't care if it doesn't have any water in it, it's full of air. We'll find out who the pessimistics in the room and the optimists in the room are. But to be able to witness that, and I share with them all the time, God knew we needed you more than you probably needed us. Do you have optimism on what God is going to do in your life? Amen. Caleb was part of the minority report. This report was the exact opposite of what the first report said. The first report said, what God said is true about the land. It does flow with milk and honey, but we cannot conquer it because they are stronger than we are. Listen, the minority report said, the land does have giants in it. But we should go up and take possession of the land, for we can certainly do it. He said, we are well able to do it. Are you optimistic about your future with God? Are you optimistic about the calling on your life from God? Are you optimistic about the promises of God in your life? Caleb was not unaware of the dangers and problems. He did not pretend that the giants did not exist. All of us have giants in our life, but he was still optimistic. Caleb did not deny the problems, but there was an optimism about him. Are we primarily optimistic or pessimistic? People who know us would say we are mostly positive, or we're mostly negative and critical. If you were one of the 12 spies sent in to do this special mission, which report would you line up with? God has called us to be to make disciples of all nations. Are we looking at what the world is doing out here and being optimistic about being able to win people for Christ? Or are we being pessimistic that said those people would never be saved? Are you optimistic? Or are you pessimist? Caleb was not aware of any of those dangers. He knew it. He knew every one of them. But he was very optimistic about it. Number three, Caleb had faith. Caleb believed God. Caleb had optimism because he had faith. He trusted God. He did not have confidence because of his own abilities. He had confidence because of God's abilities. Caleb was not optimistic because he had a great life. Listen, he had all kinds of problems. You got to remember, Caleb was born a slave. He saw how the slaves were treated. Caleb probably had bruises on his back from whippings. Caleb understood the problems. He saw the wickedness of his own people. His own friends kept dropping dead, but there was no sign that Caleb was angry with God or bitter. He was optimistic, not because of his circumstances, but because of his faith in God. He could not do this on his own, but he could do it with God's help. The Lord helping me will drive them out, just as he said in Joshua 14. He knew if God said it, he believed it, and that's it. Too many times we have negotiating Christians. We become professional negotiators. Or we try to make deals with God. Well, God, if you give me this, I'll do. Or Lord, I'm kind of short. I can't be able to make that work. We want to be negotiators, like we're professionals. The 10 spies did not have faith because they looked at their problems. Caleb had faith because he looked at God and what he could do. He had faith in the power of God. He saw the plagues of Egypt, the frogs, the gnats, the locusts. He knew about the angel of death. He saw God split the Red Sea. He saw them walk on dry ground. He saw a pillar of cloud by day and a fire by night. He saw manna coming out of heaven every day to feed them. He saw water coming out of a rock. He heard God speak audibly on the Mount Sinai. He saw the Jordan River split and they walked across dry land again. He saw the walls of Jericho come down. He had faith in God. But he was different from the other guys. Because remember, they saw the same thing. They heard the same thing. He also had faith in the promises of God. He believed that God would keep his promises, the promises he made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the promises he made to Moses. Even though he had waited 40 years and was 85 years old, he believed that God was still going to keep his promises to him. Do we have the faith and promises of God like Caleb did? I bring this message to you because I want you to start thinking as Caleb thought. I want you to start acting as Caleb act. Where is your faith? Where is your faith? Number four, Caleb had courage. Caleb was not ruled by fear. When we are focused on God, we will not fear anyone. When you focus on your problems, you're going to have all kinds of fear. Caleb was not afraid of giants. They were tall, yes. They were strong, yes. They were dangerous, yes. But Caleb was not afraid of them. He was not afraid of them the first time he spied out them 40 years earlier, and he was still not afraid of them today. Where's your courage? As a believer, He was not afraid of saying what he believed, even if it was unpopular. Woo! He was not afraid to stand out on his own. When we live in a culture that's so anti-Christ, so anti-Christian, that you get ridiculed for what you believe. What you believe. Do you have the courage of Caleb? I come to tell you this morning, you have that courage because the Holy Spirit lives on the side of inside of you. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. This message is not a message to guilt you into doing anything. This message is not a message to have you feel like you're inadequate. I am just coming to tell you what you have on the inside of you that you need to release. We all sit up here and sing this song, there's a lion inside of me that I want to be able to release that lion. That lion is ready to go. You got the key. You got the key. Yeah, he was not afraid to be able to say what he believed, even if it was unpopular. He wasn't afraid of taking a stand for truth, even if he was alone. He wasn't afraid of taking a stand for what was right, even if it meant losing his life for it. After Joshua and Caleb gave their report, people actually wanted to stone them just for suggesting it. Are you being led by fear? Or are you being led by courage? So it did not look good for Caleb and Joshua until God showed them, and the other 10 spies started dropping dead over the course of 40 years. Does this describe us? Does this describe you? Are you afraid of what people think? Are you a people pleaser? Are you willing to stand alone? Listen, it takes a certain type of person to do that. And you are that person. You are those people. You can stand for what you believe in with God. Caleb had ambition. Caleb wanted to do big things for God. We think of the word ambition in a negative way sometimes. The Bible does talk about selfish ambition, but there is also such a thing as a holy ambition. Paul had an ambition to preach the gospel where Christ had not been named. If you read Romans 15. 40 years ago, Caleb had an ambition to conquer the land of Canaan. He believed that the Israelites could conquer the land of Canaan. It would not be easy, but he believed that they could do it. He told the people not to be afraid of them and said that they would devour those giants. 45 years later, there are still some things he wanted to do, some of them big things. He is not going to let the age stop him. He's not going to let what happened 40 years ago stop. Listen, somebody has, and I don't know why this popped up, you've got to let the grudge go. You've been dealing with something for 40 years, holding on to something. You got to let it go. It will free you out of the prison of unforgiveness, and you will be able to breathe again. God wants you to breathe. Listen, Caleb is 85 years old. As I said before, he ain't no spring chicken. But he still has some things to do for God. At 85, he is not retiring. He has some more giants to defeat. He still wants to take out giants at 85 years old. I don't know if we get the significance of being 85 years old and wanting to do all of this because he believed what God said he was going to do. 85 is generally not a good age to fight anyone. I mean, I know some old people that still want to throw hands. Let's keep moving. All right. Anyway, he is still, it was not a good age to fight anyone, especially giants. Are there some things you want to do for God? Are there some things that God has put on your heart to do? Are you afraid to do it? Or do you believe in what he's going to have you do? Caleb had boldness. Caleb asked for the hardest assignment available. Listen, in Joshua 14, it says, now give me this hill, some versions, now give me this mountain that the Lord promised me that day. You yourself heard that the Anakites were there and their cities were large and fortified, but the Lord helping me, I will drive them out just as he said. Listen, most of us choose the easy path. If we have a choice to take something easy or take something hard, we're going to choose the easy path 90% of the time. It is more comfortable and requires less sacrifice. We complain if what we have to do is very hard. We complain if we have trials or difficulties. Caleb was promised. He was promised an inheritance in the promised land. But he did not want just any inheritance. He wanted the most difficult part of the land. He wanted the most dangerous area to occupy by people that the Israelites feared the most. He wanted the hardest spot in the land. He did not want the easy spot. He could have said, I am 85, I'm slowing down, give me something easy and comfortable so I can retire and take it easy. Are you afraid of trials or difficulties, or do you trust the living God? Caleb was obedient. Caleb followed God wholeheartedly. The Bible says that Caleb followed the Lord wholeheartedly. One of the greatest things that could ever be said about a person is that they followed the Lord wholeheartedly. The Bible does not say that Caleb did this one or two times. Six times it's recorded that he followed the Lord wholeheartedly. It is one thing for you to say that you follow God wholeheartedly. It is one thing for other people to say that you follow God wholeheartedly. It is another thing if God says it, and he says it about Caleb three times in Scripture. God himself said it. Even when it's difficult and he was living in the wilderness, he wholeheartedly followed the Lord, even when none of his peers were doing it. He wholeheartedly followed the Lord, even though he was a soldier. He wholeheartedly followed the Lord. Caleb was a man's man. You know, my boys love to say this about basketball players or football players, and I'm going to tell you, Caleb is him. Caleb is him. Caleb was a dog. He had vicious tenacity. Caleb was him. So do we serve God wholeheartedly? Second Corinthians 16, it says, for the eyes of the Lord range throughout the land to strengthen those whose hearts are fully committed to him. God is looking for people like Caleb. He does not see too many like him in the world or even in the church today. Caleb had a different spirit about him, which it says in Numbers 14. God even said that about him. He had a different spirit about him. And that spirit in that context is the Ruach spirit. Caleb had the Holy Spirit inside of him. Caleb was a man's man. I lost my place now. All right, here we go. Caleb was not just different from the unbelievers. He was not just different from the Canaanites. He was different from the Israelites. He was different from the people of God. Listen, here's the reality. You can follow God and serve him, but not do it wholeheartedly. Many people do that. You can go to church because you feel you are supposed to, not because you want to go, but because your heart is not in it. God wants us to serve him wholeheartedly. Paul says, serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not people. In Ephesians 6, he says, whatever you do, work at it with all your heart as working for the Lord, not for human masters, in Colossians 3. Do you have to be sinless to serve God wholeheartedly? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. You don't have to be a super Christian to serve God wholeheartedly. You have to have a heart for God. You have to be spiritually sensitive. You have to be sold out for God. You don't have to be sinless. David was a man after God's own heart, but he was not sinless. David himself. Caleb had faithfulness. If there was a case study of lifelong faithfulness, it would be Caleb. How many people start something well but don't finish well? I mean, I'm telling myself right now. I have so many projects I've started at home. Did I start it? Still working. I'm a work in progress. It's a work in progress. But some Christians start strong, They start off on fire and do all kinds of things for God as baby Christians, but they soon fizzle out. Some give up the faith entirely. They say, I used to believe in those things, but I don't now. Caleb was on fire for God when he was young and was still on fire for God when he was old. When you compare the younger Caleb with the old Caleb, you see that he has not changed much. He is the same man. He has the same faith, has same confidence, and even the same strength as Joshua 14 points out. I titled this message, Tip of the Spear. The term tip of the spear refers to the foremost element of a military force, the one that makes first contact with the enemy. Tip of the spear is the cutting edge unit or individual that is leading the way in a mission. You are part of the tip of the spear for our four-state region here. There's something special about being here in this body that God has called us to do certain things to this area to expand the kingdom of heaven for him. And there's the thing about the tip. The tip is the sharpest point of the spear. Listen, once the spear's tip has made contact, the rest of the spear can be effective for maximum damage. We are in a spiritual warfare. And Pastor Joel is one about plowing new ground for the kingdom of heaven. And you are a part of that. There are things when you leave out of this room this each and every week, there's things that we hope that God has spoke to your heart to go out and change your circle of influence like never before. You are called by God to do these things. The spear, now listen, it's made for close contact. It's not as effective as the enemy is far away. We love our online. We absolutely love our online and broadcasting our message online. But we are more effective in face-to-face. You are more effective to face-to-face. Many people sit around waiting for someone to invite them to church. A lot of times we leave that up to the officers of the church. You are soldiers in the army of the Lord. This is what makes Caleb an unsung hero. The mindset will also make you an unsung hero. Listen, in Numbers 13:30, Caleb says, then Caleb quieted the people before Moses and said, we should by all means go up and take possession of it, for we will surely overcome it. He knew God's promise for them, and he believed if God promised it, he's faithful to fulfill it. I believe that we are the tip of the spear at TWBC. My dad used to say something all the time. God said it. I believe it. That's it. That's it. He said it. I believe it. That's it. I believe we all are here to impact a nation as Caleb did. Many of you don't feel qualified to be a Caleb today. I come to tell you, you've been qualified. If you are a believer in this room, you've been qualified to have every one of those attributes that Caleb had. You have to get up off your seat and have faith to step out and do what God has called you to do. Every one of you. Every one of you. And I have scripture to prove it. Ephesians 4:11 and 12. And he gave some as apostles, some as prophets, and some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers. Listen, for the equipping of the saints, for the work of service, to the building up of the body of Christ. The church is not a gathering place for spectators. It's a training ground for warriors. You've got to see yourself different. You've got to see yourself the way God sees you. We gather every week together for exalting the name of Jesus and giving him glory, but also Jesus gave us a mandate to go and make disciples of all nations, of all people. The singing is amazing. I hope the preaching is good today. But if we leave it in this building, it's all for nothing. It's all for nothing. Listen, this, and I shared this one time before, and it staggers me. Hopkins County alone, and we have people that come over from all the four counties that's surrounding this place, and even further in some places. But Hopkins County alone has nearly 40,000 people that call Hopkins County home. 40% of that 40,000 people are unchurched. They're unchurched. Listen, when God gave birth to the church in the first century, he used apostles and prophets to establish healthy believers by means of writing down the New Testament scriptures. Today, God continues to build up the size of, and strength of the body of Christ through the work of evangelists, whom they serve as missionaries around the world, and pastors and teachers, both of whom teach the scriptures to people. So what's God's goal behind the fivefold ministry teaching the Bible to people? God's answer to the question is in verse 12. It is the job of the evangelists and pastors is to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. So listen, now let's compare God's job description compared to our stereotypical pastor's job description. Pastors are expected to preach. They're expected to lead. They're expected to administer. They're expected to visit. They're expected to marry, bury, care for people, and counsel. In many people's minds, he is supposed to be the Superman generalist who does all the ministry for the flock, putting out all the fires, all in all the squeaky wheels, and solving all the problems. But listen, it's all backwards because Ephesians 4:12, it tells us, it makes it very clear that a pastor's main role is to equip and prepare God's people to do the work of the ministry. By training the members to meet each other's needs, our primary job is to help you grow spiritually so that you become willing and able to do the ministry of the church. That you will be able to become willing and able to do the work of the church. Look again at verse 12, for equipping of the saints for the work of service. Listen, that word equipping comes from the Greek word, I'm going to get it, katartizo, which speaks of repairing and preparing a person's life in order to equip him or her and get them ready for service. Listen, this same word is used in Matthew 4:21. It says that it describes James and John as they repaired and repaired and prepared their nets for fishing. This involved cleaning the nets of seaweed and sticks, then mending parts of their nets that had been torn or damaged, and then untangling and unfolding their nets so that they would be quickly usable at a moment's notice. All of this preparation was so that their nets would be ready to catch more fish. These nets were not prepared for storage, but for service. You are not prepared for storage. You're prepared for service. You are prepared to serve the living God. Amen. Listen, God won't give you a task without the gift. Amen. He will not give you the task without the gift. Listen, I love the military. It said the military is trained, equipped, commissioned by Congress, and appointed by the president. The expectation for the military is that they are capable and willing to conduct whatever operation necessary to meet the objectives. Listen, you are commissioned by God Almighty to complete the task that is put before you. You are commissioned by God Himself. The way it works is that through the process of being equipped, trained, prepared, and completed, you're restored to your proper dignity as ministers. Most of you never saw yourself as a minister. 1 Peter 2, it says, if you are a believer, you are a priest. Maybe you see yourself as just a regular, everyday Christian, but God sees you as part of a holy and royal priesthood. The Bible calls you a priest. What it means is that you and I are spiritually equals. I am no better than you in the eyes of God. The fact that I wear the title pastor is insignificant. God gives you authority to do ministry. God gives you authority to do ministry. You are not a second-class Christian. You are a minister. We have an entire room full of ministers here this morning. That includes you, every one of you. So listen, if God has given you the vision to take the city, take the dang city. take the city. He's got big things for you. And I'm going to tell you, once that first one is over through, you build more confidence. You grow more in the faith. You start to believe in yourself. He already believes in you. It takes an act of faith. As the worship team is coming up, and our prayer partners are coming up as well, listen, in order to take the city, we need to look again at verse 13 from Joshua 14. So Joshua blessed him and gave Hebron to Caleb, the son of Jephunneh, for an inheritance. Caleb remembered God's promise, and he was blessed with an inheritance. I encourage you today to remember God's promises for us. The Bible is filled with promises. And you can obtain your inheritance. I tell my boys all the time. Sometimes they look at the, you know, serving on the cameras, you know, for online service. I said, you don't realize the impact. Just being behind that camera, serving, that's going to have on somebody's life. Imagine if you made it to heaven, and someone is there to tell you thank you that the gospel was reached to them through their phone because of what you were doing wholeheartedly for the kingdom of heaven. Listen, you guys, every Sunday we have 150 to 225 fifth grade and under kids that come through here. We have some amazing leaders. And I'm going to tell you, those kids are on fire for God. Many of them, every Sunday, are leading their parents to church. We have amazing opportunities to serve here, and it's not about you serving, to make you serve in the church. But I'm going to tell you, if what you do and here inside these four walls on Sunday morning does not impact you for the rest of the 6 days of the week, we're missing it. I'm going to read off some promises to you, just a few that the Bible is loaded with. Romans 1, God promised salvation to all who believe in his son. 2 Corinthians 1, God promised comfort in our lives. 2 Corinthians 5, God promised new life in Christ. Philippians 1, God promised to finish the work he started in us. He promised to finish it. Philippians 4, God promised peace when we pray. Matthew 6 and Philippians 4, God promised to supply our needs. Ephesians 1, God promised every spiritual blessing in Christ. Matthew 11, God promised rest. John 10, God promises abundant life to those who follow him. Acts 1, God promised his disciples power from on high. 1 Peter 1, our inheritance is reserved for us. If you go ahead and stand with me this morning, as you're standing, I want you to reach back and touch the seat where you were sitting down at. It should be warm, right? It should be warm. I heard this from another pastor that blessed my heart. He said, in the church, traditionally, they call them pews because if you sit there too long, they start to stink. We don't want no stinking pews here at the Way Bible Church. We are called as pastors, as elders, as leaders of this church. We're called to equip you guys to do the work of the ministry. To tear down the strongholds that the enemy has put up through the power of the Holy Spirit. You are qualified. If you're in this room and don't know Christ as your Savior, and need to know how qualified you are by becoming a believer, our prayer partners up here. And you can just come up and say, I want to be qualified. There's many places to serve the body of Christ. in many ways. Listen, find your unique niche and run with it with all your heart. Run with it with all your heart. Just like Caleb, we can believe his promises, follow him wholeheartedly, and we can be the tip of the spear and receive our inheritance that's set for us. You guys got to start looking at yourself how God sees you. He don't see the beaten, battered, bruised, not good enough person. Matter of fact, when he sees you, he sees his son's blood over you. You are qualified. You are qualified. You are qualified. And fear has no hold on you no more. So as we go into this last worship song, we have prayer partners up here. If you want to come and kneel down at the altar, you may do that as well. Don't leave this room today feeling unqualified. There's a vicious tenacity that's waiting to get out on the inside of you. Father, we thank you for what you're doing in this place. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your anointing. We thank you for your anointing. You have called us to do greater things for the kingdom like never before. You said it, we believe it, and it's final. Thank you, Father, and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Bless God when nobody's watching.
watching every chance I get. I bless your name. Bless God when the weapons for me. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God cause he goes before me. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God for he holds the victory. Bless God for he's always with me. Bless God cause he's always worthy. Every chance I get, come on, sing it again. Bless God in the sanctuary. Bless God in the fields of plenty. Bless God in the darkest valley. Every chance I get, I bless your name. Bless God when my hands are empty. Bless God when the praise that cost me. Bless God when nobody's watching. Every chance I get. God, we bless you today. We thank you for who you are. God, we bless you at all times, at all moments. God, we sing your praise, even in the darkest valley. God, we bless you. We sing praises to your name. When we go out this week, wanted to love the people around us, that they would come to know the saving grace of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. Hey, thank you so much for being here. We're so glad to see you today. Young adults, 18 to 29, see you Tuesday at 6:30. We love you. We'll see you next week.